In this video, we're going to discuss optimality of extreme points. In the previous video, we have already understood the necessary and sufficient conditions for the existence of extreme points. So now instead, we focus on optimality. The first result that we're going to see in this video is the theorem 2.7. Let's read through this theorem. Consider the LP problem of minimizing C transpose X over a polyhedron P. Suppose that P has at least one extreme point and that there exists an optimal solution. Then there exists an optimal solution which is an extreme point of P. Now we're going to prove theorem 2.7, but before that, let me make a couple of comments. The first is that this theorem finally confirms the intuition that we developed in chapter 1, namely that in most linear programming problems, there's always an optimal solution which is an extreme point of P. And this is also the intuition that we formalized at the beginning of chapter 2, and this is the intuition that we formalized as the third fundamental property of linear programming problems at the beginning of chapter 2. My second comment is about some direct consequences of this theorem. Namely, in this theorem, we are asking that P has at least one extreme point. And we've already seen in the previous video some classes of polyhedra that do have extreme points. Namely, polyhedra in standard form and polytopes, as long as they're non-empty. So in these cases, theorem 2.7 implies that if there exists an optimal solution, then there exists an extreme point that is an optimal solution. Now we're ready to prove theorem 2.7. Let's write down the system defining P. Let P be the set of points in Rn such that Ax greater than or equal to B. And let V be the optimal cost. Let's now define the set of all optimal solutions. This is the set of points in P that have cost V. Let's call this set Q. Ax greater than or equal to B is the system defining P, and then on top of that we need to ask for the cost to be exactly V, and so we write C transpose X equal to V. So with respect to P, we only added an equality constraint, which immediately implies that Q is a polyhedron. Also, this polyhedron is non-empty because by assumption we know that there exists an optimal solution. So what do we have to show in this theorem? We need to show that there exists a point in Q which is an extreme point of P. So the first thing we're going to do is prove that Q has an extreme point, and then we pick that extreme point and show that it's also an extreme point of P. So the first thing we want to show is that Q has an extreme point, and in order to show that, we use the equivalence between having an extreme point and containing no lines. So let's start from P. Since P has an extreme point, from theorem 2.6, P contains no lines. Since Q is contained in P, by definition, also Q contains no lines. So let's use the equivalence again, therefore. By the same theorem, 2.6, Q has an extreme point. So let's pick an extreme point of Q, and we're going to show that it's also an extreme point of P. Let X star be an extreme point of Q. We show that X star is an extreme point of P. We're going to show this by contradiction. So we suppose, for a contradiction, that X star is not an extreme point of P. What does it mean using the definition of extreme point? Then there exists Y and Z in P different from X star and a coefficient lambda in the interval 0, 1 such that X star is equal to lambda y plus 1 minus lambda z. Now, in order to obtain a contradiction, let's write down the optimal cost. So the optimal cost is v, which is of course c transpose x star. And now we substitute x star with a formula from the definition of extreme point. So we obtain that c transpose x star is equal to lambda c transpose y plus 1 minus lambda C transpose Z. Now, what can we say about C transpose Y and C transpose Z in this formula? Since V is an optimal cost, both must be greater than or equal to V. Since V is the optimal cost, C transpose Y is greater than or equal to V, and C transpose Z is greater than or equal to V. And this implies that actually both C transpose Y and C transpose Z must be equal to V. How can you see that? Well, with the standard trick that we've already seen, we can use the two inequalities that we just obtained in the formula above to obtain that the formula is greater than or equal to lambda v plus 1 minus lambda v, which of course equals to v. So in this chain of relations, we have v greater than or equal to v. But of course we know that v is equal to v, and this implies that the two inequalities that we used in the derivation are actually equalities. In other words, c transpose y is equal to v, and c transpose z is equal to v. So we have obtained that both y and z are in Q. And this contradicts the fact that x star is an extreme point of Q. So we've shown that X star is an extreme point of P. Of course, it's optimal because it belongs to Q. So we have shown that X star is an optimal extreme point of P, and that's everything we needed to show. This completes the proof of the theorem. Let's get back to the slides. Now that we have shown theorem 2.7, I want to talk about a theorem that is actually stronger than 2.7. This new theorem, which is theorem 2.8, gives a nice sufficient condition for the existence of an optimal solution. And the sufficient condition is that the optimal cost is not minus infinity. So let's read through the theorem. We consider the LP problem of minimizing C transpose X over a polyhedron P. And we assume that P has at least one extreme point. Then only two things can happen. Either the optimal cost is equal to minus infinity, or there exists an extreme point which is optimal. So why did I say that theorem 2.8 is stronger than theorem 2.7? To see that in a more direct way, let's rephrase theorem 2.8 so that it has the same conclusion as the theorem 2.7. Again, consider the LP problem of minimizing C transpose X over P, and suppose that P has at least one extreme point. So far, all this part of the theorem is also present in theorem 2.7. However, in theorem 2.8, though, we can continue by saying, assume that the optimal cost is not equal to minus infinity, then there exists an extreme point which is optimal. Now, going back to theorem 2.7, we see that in theorem 2.7, instead we assume that there exists an optimal solution, and then we have the same conclusion. Now, theorem 2.7 is weaker because the assumptions of theorem 2.7 are stronger. Namely, we're asking that there exists an optimal solution, while in theorem 2.8, we're asking that the optimal cost is not equal to minus infinity. Now, the condition in theorem 2.7 is stronger, because if there exists an optimal solution, then clearly the optimal cost is not minus infinity. So now that we've discussed theorem 2.8 and its relationship with theorem 2.7, let's see a sketch of the proof of theorem 2.8. To prove theorem 2.8, we assume that the optimal cost is not minus infinity and show that there exists an extreme point which is optimal. I will not write down a complete proof of this theorem, and I leave it as an exercise to you. Now, the idea to prove this theorem is very similar to the idea to prove the implication B implies A in theorem 2.6. If you remember, in that proof we were starting from a vector x in our polyhedron, then we were choosing a direction d along which all the active constraints at x remain active, and among these two directions we were choosing one along which we would eventually leave the polyhedron. Then we stopped at the boundary, finding a new linearly independent active constraints, and repeated the process. Now, the difference with respect to that proof is that we have different assumptions here. Now, in this proof, we use a similar construction to actually find an extreme point which is optimal. In particular, when we are at the vector x at the specific iteration, we only want to move in a direction which decreases the costs of x or leaves it unchanged. So this is how we decide between going along the direction d or minus d. If one of the two decreases the cost, then the other one increases the cost, and we choose the one that decreases the cost. We are guaranteed that going in that direction, we will eventually leave the polyhedron, because if we didn't, then we would obtain points with cost arbitrarily low, which implies that the optimal cost is minus infinity. And this gives us a contradiction. So is this the only difference in the proof with respect to the previous one? Well, no, because there's a technical case that needs a further discussion. Namely, it can happen that the vector d that you choose is such that along that direction, the cost of our solution doesn't change at all. So it neither increases nor decreases. In this case, in order to being able to choose a direction among these two that will eventually leave the polyhedron, we need to use the other assumption, namely that P has at least one extreme point. In fact, this assumption implies that P doesn't contain any line, therefore at least one among the two directions d and minus d will eventually leave the polyhedron, and we will choose exactly that direction among the two. At this point we're done, because these are the only two differences in the proof with respect to the proof of theorem 2.6 B implies A. Again, I strongly encourage you to write down a complete proof. So let's now talk about the case in which theorem 2.8 cannot be applied, which is the case in which P has no extreme points. In this case, the conclusion of theorem 2.8 is in fact wrong, because it can happen that in this linear programming problem, the optimal cost is not equal to minus infinity and there is no extreme point which is optimal. It is a great exercise for you to come up with an example when this happens. As a hint, you only need dimension 2 and you only need a polyhedron that is defined by a linear inequality, so essentially just a half space. So we just said that for linear programming problems that don't have extreme points, we cannot argue that there's always an optimal solution that is a vertex. Still, what can we say about these linear programming problems? Well, we can make an interesting connection between this type of general linear programming problems and linear programming problem in standard form, for which we know that the theorem 2.8 actually applies. In fact, we know that any linear programming problem can be transformed into an equivalent problem in standard form. And the idea is then to apply to this equivalent linear programming problem, theorem 2.8. Theorem 2.8 then tells us that the standard form problem does have an optimal solution that is an extreme point. The fact that the optimal solution is an extreme point doesn't really mean much for our original linear programming problem. However, the fact that they're equivalent immediately tells us that the original linear programming problem has an optimal solution as well. This is how we then obtain the following corollary of theorem 2.8. Consider the LP problem of minimizing C transpose x over a non-empty polyhedron. Then, either the optimal cost is equal to minus infinity or there exists an optimal solution. Clearly, the assumptions of corollary 2.3 are more general than the assumptions in theorem 2.8, because here we're not assuming that P has extreme points. As a consequence, the thesis of the corollary will be weaker than that of the theorem, and in fact, we can only argue that either the optimal cost is minus infinity, as in the theorem, or there exists an optimal solution. So while we argue that there exists an optimal solution, which is already very interesting, we cannot argue that an optimal solution will be an extreme point. Now that we've understood corollary 2.3, we have convinced ourselves of the first fundamental property of linear programming problems that we discussed at the beginning of the chapter. Namely, any linear programming problem is either infeasible, or the optimal cost is minus infinity, or there exists an optimal solution. We've already contrasted this result with what can happen with nonlinear cost functions. In fact, if you remember, we have seen this problem where we minimize the nonlinear function 1 over x over the one-dimensional polyhedron defined by x greater than or equal to 1. We saw that in this case the optimal cost is not minus infinity, but no optimal solution exists. So here's a recap of the fundamental properties that we discussed at the beginning of the chapter. And as you can see, at this point we've fully understood property 1, which follows from corollary 2.3, and property 3, which follows from theorem 2.7. Later in the course, we will also fully prove property 2. This concludes our video on optimality of extreme points. The next time, we're gonna discuss a different representation of polytopes.